بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وبه نستعين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين حبيب قلوبنا وطبيب نفوسنا رحمة للعالمين أبي القاسم محمد والصلاة والسلام على أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين ولعنة الله على أعدائهم أجمعين اللهم كن لوليك الحجة ابن الحسن صلواتك عليه وعلى آبائه في هذه الساعة وفي كل ساعة وليا وحافظا وقائدا وناصرا ودليلا وعينا حتى تسكنه أرضك طوعا وتمتعه فيها طويلا برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم صل على محمد
اللهم صل على محمد
اما بعد السلام علیکم ورحمۃ اللہ وبرکاتہ All praise and glory belongs to Allah the creator of this universe may the peace and blessings of Allah be upon the best of his creations that he chose for humanity that he has created for his submission for them to understand who he is and how to submit to his will And out of the best of his creations, he chose the best of his creations. The last of the prophets, Hazrat Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide us with his deep understanding so that we can develop a state of love inside of our hearts. We can develop contentment in our mind as our logic states and that all of this is reflected in our actions. So as far as the recap is concerned, Agha has done a decent job and I won't go too much into it, but if you are coming, you should try to come as often as possible because we'll try to take this topic which is understanding the shape of Tawheed that Imam Hussain alayhi wasallam sacrificed to save it. Right? It's a little bit of a long topic or a long statement, but we have to understand that there has been and there is still different shapes of Tawheed. Just because of the fact that you say Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, that does not guarantee that you or I understand what that Allah is or what that ilah is or what that la is. And what does it mean for us to bear witness to that fact? Because the people who stood against Imam Hussain alayhi wasallam, they were also saying, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, they also said, Ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. And throughout the 250 years that Imam Masumin alayhi wasallam lived after the Prophet, all of them were martyred, whether it was through poison or sword. By not Christians and not by Jews. They were all martyred by people who call themselves to believe in Tawheed. People who call themselves that they believed in Islam. People who had acted on the Furu'ad-Deen. They used to fast, they used to pray namaz, they used to go for hajj. They used to do some sort of zakat, they used to do some sort of amar bil ma'ruf wa nahy anil munkar and so forth. Yet what you see is that atrocities has been committed and are still being committed in the name of Tawheed. Where those individuals who do not believe in Islam are being cut, their necks have been cut and graphically put onto the net where everybody can see that this is what a Muslim who believes in one God does to somebody who does not submit to the same God. And it is continuing. Even among our own selves, when somebody was to ask you, what does it mean to say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah? What do you say? And I always ask you questions and you don't really reply, which becomes a little bit odd of awkward silence. So if you want to avoid the awkward silence, And there is no tricky questions that I'm asking you. It's just very simple questions, and there is no wrong answers because they're very easy. So when somebody says Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, what is it translated as? What do you say? I bear witness. The one God? Okay. So we're already getting 3-4 different translations. Even when we say Bismillah Rahman Rahim, this is that we say all the time. What does it mean? In the name of Allah, the beneficent and the merciful. Rahman and Rahim, they're both from Rahm, from the same root, but one here we are translating as beneficence, the other as mercy. The translation of Bismillah, which is the closest to the actual Arabic, is that I begin in the name of Allah, or I seek assistance in the name of Allah, the entirely merciful, the especially merciful. Because Rahman means mercy, but this mercy is entire for everybody. Whether that person happens to be a human being, whether that person is a Muslim, whether that person is a non-Muslim, whether the person believes him or not. Whether it is a tree, whether it is a sky, whether it is the mountains, whether it is anything that he has created, is entirely merciful to all of his creations. That's what Rahman means. But Rahim means that especially merciful, that this circle of his mercy is not for everybody. Somebody who decides by the power of their choice and will and actions to enter into that circle, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is especially merciful for them, and that is specifically for the believers. That he will have his mercy in this world also and also in the hereafter. But not to everybody. Meaning what? Just from translating Bismillah Rahman Rahim, we understand that Yazid is not going to be in the circle of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We know that the enemies of Ahlul Bayt are not going to be in the special mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because they chose wrong, they were on the wrong path, they decided to commit the atrocities against the family of the Prophet and deteriorate and destroy the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yet you have Muslims who believe that if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the Day of Judgment wishes to put Yazid la'natullah alayh in heaven, he can. Just from the translation of Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. The word ilah, and we will keep coming back to our topic, but let's still work on that Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. So you say, I bear witness that there is no God other than Allah. Takriban, because you had different translations, so if you agree with that translation, you can recite aloud salawat and we'll go forward. Right. Okay, so what does the Christian say? The Christian says that I believe that there is no God other than the Almighty. They don't use the word Allah, but they say that I believe in one God, I don't believe in other gods. If wherever I'm wrong, just correct me, please. Just raise your hand and tell me that I'm wrong. What does a Jew say? That I believe in one God and I don't believe in the rest of the gods. If you were going to understand Tawheed just like that, that there is no God other than Allah, then the difference between you and a Jew and a Christian is just that the word Allah. The rest remains the same. That's why Islam is always put into a monotheistic religion. And when you put Islam in the monotheistic religion, there's also Jews and there's also Christians. So where is our difference? If you're going to put Islam as a monotheistic religion, as a Semitic religion, you know this how they say anti-Semite? There were 24 nations that were called Semitic nations, and religions of Judaism and Christianity, they are Semitic religions, and also Islam is a Semitic religion. Because those nations that believe in those religions are called Semitic nations. So in reality, anti-Semite, anybody who is Islamophobic or says anything against Islam is also anti-Semite. But today's world doesn't really understand that. The people who believed in Hazrat Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, who were they? Were they all not Muwahid? Did they not believe in Tawheed? Were they not Muslim? Ji? Easy question, na, to bata de. Ji? Right? The people who believed in Hazrat Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, at the time of Hazrat Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, they were Muslim because there is only one religion that had inna deena indallahi al-Islam. There is only one religion with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that is Islam. And Islam has 124,000 prophets, and Hazrat Musa alayhi salatu wasalam happens to be one of them. So therefore, anybody who followed Hazrat Musa alayhi salatu wasalam at his time, they were Muslims and he was a Muslim. So was Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, so was Hazrat Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, and the rest of the prophets that Jews and Christians believe in. So why is it that today you have Judaism and Christianity and Islam? The simple answer to that, where we can build, and I will keep coming back to this point, is that it is in the understanding of who that one God is. Where you become mawahid, where you understand Tawheed, is the understanding of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of that Almighty. Your understanding will determine whether you are a believer or a non-believer. The people who understood Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at the time of Imam Hussain alayhi salatu wasalam, they understood him wrong. They understood that Allah, that whatever is happening, that you can cut the neck of the grandson of the Prophet and still it is okay. Is that the understanding? They understood the justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be wrong. They understood the destiny, the creed, the qada and qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be wrong. They understood wrong what the status of a prophet is and who is supposed to sit down after the prophet. They understood Quran wrong. What was the difference? The difference was simple. Allahumma a'rifni nafsak. Oh Allah, make me understand your essence. فَإِنْ لَمْ تُعْرِفْنِي نَفْسَكْ لَمْ أَعْرِفْ نَبِيَكْ. If I do not understand your essence, I will not understand your prophet. And if I do not understand your prophet, I will not understand my imam. And if I do not understand my imam, I will be misguided in my religion. ضَلَلْتُ عَنْ دِينِي. And all of our problems also stem from the simple fact that we do not understand who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. When they say that mu'mineen are fighting and the centers are being divided and people are, you know, divided on the azaa of Imam Hussain or on taqleed or on the other issues, the reason for that is that we haven't understood Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you were to bring all of the 124,000 prophets into one room, they have no disagreement. Why? Because of their understanding who their Lord is. When you claim to say Allah is your Lord, but your lowly desires are your Lord, then really your God is not Allah, is your own self. It's your own self, it is your own ego, and your statement of Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah is actually incorrect and it is a lie. Because there is no other God, there is another God, and that is your ego. That there is another God, that is money. That there is another God, that is this kursi. That there is another God, which is called Samson. We should talk about the modern gods. I happen to have one of those too. And the latest one, almost. That someone's God is a car. Someone's God is a career. Someone's God is a wife. Goddess, sorry. Someone's God is children. Someone's God is just one of the rituals of azaa. that they have to submit to. If they do not, it is as if they have committed a sin. When you have so many gods, how are we going to be united? The Muslims, if they were ever united, they were united under the banner of Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. And when we are going to be united, that is at the time of the Imam of our time, because he is going to unite us on the basis of the Tawheed that Imam Hussein saved in Karbala. Not on the understanding of you and I. Because our understanding of Tawheed is just that. We believe in one God. Who is Allah? I don't know. But he is there. So let's go back to that statement. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. I bear witness. If you happen to be called tomorrow in the Supreme Court of UK as a witness, guess what's going to happen? They're going to ask you, did you hear the crime? Did you see the crime? Were you present when the crime was committed? What do you say? I'm sorry, sir. I didn't hear it. I didn't see it. And I was not present. So, but what have you come to witness here? What have you come to witness? If you ask somebody, you're bearing witness that there is no other God other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Have you heard him? Have you seen him? Are you present? Are you present in his presence? No, I'm not. So what are you bearing witness to? Any witness is cross-questioned. You cannot just accept a person, they come on the stand and they're like, I'm a witness. The lawyer cross-questions the witness if to see whether the witness is correct, is saying the truth or is lying. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cross-questions on daily basis on every single test that he brings us to. In the statement that we have said, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, we are cross-questioned on daily basis. No, you get sick. Who's going to give you shafa? Who's going to make you better? See? Doctors. Once the doctors, they say, I'm sorry, your illness is that you're going to die, then the person goes to ziyarat, the person puts the musalla down, the person goes for hajj, and says, oh Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, please help me. When an opportunity comes to submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or to your lowly desires, if we submit to our lowly desires, we have lost our credibility of that statement that we said, La ilaha illallah. Every single time that we commit an atrocity, a sin, it is going against our statement of La ilaha illallah. I cannot have a beard. Why? Because my job dictates, my wife doesn't like it, I look a bit old, so I'm not going to have it. Well, it's wajib, it's an obligation, but I'm not going to have it. What is that? Well, la ilaha illallah, there is nobody else other than Allah. Who are you afraid of? Wife? You're afraid of your job? You're afraid of your boss? Who are you afraid of? If you're afraid of any of those, then your statement of la ilaha illallah, it becomes incorrect. I'm not going to pray namaz, I'm going to watch my basketball game because I know you guys watch soccer. You know, Chelsea is playing or Manchester United is playing or what's this guy's name who's really good with his legs?
Ronaldo.
Yeah, he's alright too. There's Messi as well, right? I don't know if you guys are fans of that or not. Well, he's playing and it's the final and everything else, and you know, I want to know my team wins or not, so the namaz is there. I'm not going to pray namaz, I'm going to watch the game. Your statement of la ilaha illallah now is incorrect. Every time we go to sleep and we don't get up for fajr again, now if you go through your whole life, anytime you have not submitted to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then whoever will you are submitted to, this la ilaha illallah becomes wrong. That you are not a credible witness anymore. This bearing witness of la ilaha illallah is actually a lie. So the poetry that Agha recites that we only submitted to one God and we became successful in all of the courts. But those are the statements said by somebody who sacrificed everything that they had in Karbala. They showed with their actions that their statement of La ilaha illallah was correct. Now Imam Hussein becomes Aba Abdullah, the father of the submission to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So now we get to the point, we're going to go through another of this translation. So we say Ashad one, La. La means? La ka matlab kya hota hai? Nahi. Ilah? Ji? Nahi. La ilah. God. That's what we translate as? So when you translate Ilah as God, it becomes a little bit problematic. When you go back and you look at the word Ilah in the Arabic text, because when the Prophet came and he said, Qulu la ilaha illallah tuflihu, no kafir, no unbeliever at that time, mushrik in Makkah, stood up and said, first, tell us who this Allah is. True? They said, we're not going to say this statement. Meaning what? They understood what la ilaha illallah meant. If they had an issue what Ilah means, they would have asked, okay, we will say it, right? We will bear witness to that. But first tell us what this Ilah is and tell us what this Allah is. They never said that. They said, we're not going to say it. Why? Because they understood. And the Prophet said, if you say La ilaha illallah, you will become successful. Because in their context, in their language, Ilah meant, they used to use this word for a being that was beautiful in such a way that all of the emotions, they come in front when you are in front of that beauty. Meaning, the emotions, they come when you are in front of something which is beautiful. With me? What are those emotions that come when you are in front of something beautiful? You are attracted. You want to go close. You want to obey. Yes or no? You want to obey, you want to fall in love. So when they had somebody who was worthy of obedience, love and worship, they called it Ilah. When you take the word God, yes, to somebody who's God, it is, they have taught themselves that it is worthy, that this God is worthy of love, obedience and worship. Right? We say that when you look at other people's God, you look at a cow that's a God for some people, that cow cannot be my God because it, to me, that cow is not worthy of love, obedience or worship because it's an animal. When you say that God is that figurine that they make with porcelain or with wood or with whatever it is, that this is cannot be, it's not worthy of love, obedience or worship. It's a man-made article. It's an object. So anybody who's going to say God, what they are saying is this, the translation I did of Ilah, that they think that something is worthy of love, obedience or worship. They even used to use the Ilah in their poetry for a beautiful woman that people used to fall in love with, would worship them and would obey them. But he says, La ilaha illallah. Meaning what? That Allah is so beautiful that in front of Him, all of the emotions of something when you are in front of that beauty, love, obedience and worship comes, plus your mind tries to find a fault but cannot find it. Are you with me? You know, you used to in Urdu for a Maulana to do this. And what I've seen you guys do is you recite a salawat or something. But here you just stay quiet. Right? So Allah is a being in front of whom when somebody comes in front of that being, the beauty is so magnanimous, it's so stunning that all of the emotions of love, obedience and worship are there and the mind is trying to find a fault but can't find it. The mind is just overwhelmed. Right? So they would say, this is Allah. So what is the translation now? That I bear witness that there is nobody, no being, no nothing worthy of love, obedience, or worship other than that beautiful being that is worthy of love, obedience, and worship, and the mind cannot comprehend it, that there is a fault in it. This is a very different shape of Tawheed. It is a completely new venue, new path, new doors for us to open. That now you are in search of something which is beautiful, in which you are, your emotions are such that you fall in love, that you obey, that you are in obedience, and your mind just goes in awe. Right? When you go in front of something, it's a beautiful flower. And like I was telling you yesterday, we don't really use the tools Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us to actually see His beauty or His understanding. If you were just to sit down, okay, just sit down tonight and just look at something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created and just think for half an hour on it, that's all. And try to find a fault. Try to find a fault. Look at the sky. Try to find a fault. You won't find a fault. Your mind will... Science is boggled by it. The creation that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created. To the point that science has come to the point saying that there cannot be a creator like that who has created all of this. This must be a big bang. Cannot understand the magnanimity, the complexity, the beauty in the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that it is baffled, says that there cannot be any one being that mighty, that wise, that knowledgeable, that powerful who can create all of this. They're finding new universes, new galaxies, new stars, new planets. Void, they discovered a void in space that is the most biggest void that should not actually exist. Dark matter doesn't exist in there, it's actually void. Dark matter exists in all of the universe, 96.4% of it is all dark matter, the rest is the matter that we know. When I'm talking to you, some of you are thinking like I'm talking to you in Chinese. Bhai, I'm talking in English and I'm telling you about the creation of the Allah that you call is your God. So when you start looking at just the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you go look for beauty, this is what you will find. Now, what happens to us is that the beauty is in the eye of the beholder. This is where problem comes. If you were to see the beauty outside of the eye of the beholder, you will only find that the beauty that exists is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, nothing else. But when you put beauty in the eye of the beholder, then you're limiting that beauty, and that beauty is going to be specific to all one of us. That is going to create many different beautiful things, and then there will be many gods, but not Allah. And that's the problem of this world today. Samson is beautiful in the eye of somebody who loves Samson. Right? And then iPhone becomes beautiful in the eyes of somebody who loves Apple. And then, what are the other phones that are not even in existence anymore? Like Hi-Chi or I don't know, LG or Sony or Xperia. Or, you know, what are the other ones? Nokia. Nokia, I think, almost is done. So, you find people, you know, geared, having emotions of love, you're towards these things because in their eyes they have become beautiful. Like you go outside, you'll see a BMW, you'll see a Benz, you'll see a Toyota, you'll see all of this. And everybody, will probably be saying to protect their own ego, I have the best car. And if somebody is crazy about BMWs, that's it. The BMWs is achhi gaadi hai nahi. Agar koi Mercedes ke Mercedes bhai aapki BMW kuch bhi nahi, Mercedes ke saath aao race lagaye, let's go and have a race, you'll see. Mercedes becomes better as it gets old. What about your car?
Now what about Filmera?
Ji?
Filmera that has been destroyed in Syria.
Yeah. The artifacts and so forth, we'll get to it. Right? Let's stay with the topic and what I'm saying here. If you can recite aloud, salawat. So when you leave the beauty in the eye of the beholder, you're going to have many different things that are going to become beautiful. And when many different things, even like, let's still, because I'm supposed to be talking for the youth, so let's also give them something. There are people who are die-hard fans of Xbox. Xbox One, I think, is the newest console, right? Die-hard fans of Xbox One. Then there are die-hard fans of PS4. To them, Xbox is not really a console, somebody who loves PS4. Right? True? Or if you go further, a particular dress or a type of fashion becomes beautiful in someone's eyes, and that's all they're going to have, the fashion. That's all, this is all the clothes that are ever made, it's just that is good. If those people were a bit older, bell bottom and the huge collars, when they were in fashion, that was beauty. Somebody who has like these huge collars and pants that are like this wide, this was beautiful. And that became fashion, and anybody who wore that is beautiful, is handsome. Same thing happens for our sisters too. Certain things, they come in fashion and they go away, and when they are in fashion, when they wear it, oh, you are so beautiful. When beauty starts existing in the eye of the beholder, it becomes limited and actually becomes even ugly. Where things that are not beautiful, they become ugly. You know, the lipsticks that our sisters end up using, if you were to go and search up how lipsticks are made, and from the cells of swine and from the cells of such and such animal, and from this animal's, you know, liver or this animal, and they're putting on their lips. Go take a look sometimes. And somebody who's wearing that, the other person, look how beautiful she is. Or mascaras and all this other stuff that, you know, our sisters, they put on their faces. Try to see where they're made, how they're made. If you were to see that thing without that color and without that glitter, you would not even want to touch it. You would say, I want to be staying away from it. But it's the glitter that makes the ugly look beautiful. And this glitter boggles our mind and we become that. In Dua Nutbah, which we will recite tomorrow, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that I chose these prophets, I took a promise from them because I knew they're not going to break the promise, and the glitter and the glamour of this world is not going to make them break the promise. The prophets do not get glitterized or glamorized by things that are actually ugly, because the only thing that is beautiful in their eyes is the true beauty, and that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you can recite a lot, salawat.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Zuyyana lin-nas hubbu shahawati min an-nisa'i wal-banin wal-kanatir al-muqantarati min al-dhahab wal-fidda wal-khayl al-musawwamati min والخيل المصومة والأنعام والحرث ذلك متاع الحياة الدنيا. Surah Al-Imran, the verse says that it becomes beautified. زُيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ. For people it becomes beauty. It's made beautiful. زُيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ حُبُّ الشَّهَوَاتِ مِنَ النِّسَاءِ وَالْبَنِينَ. The desire, the love of women and children. والقناطير المقنطرة من الذهب والفضة, and big huge mountains of gold and silver. If you were to see the big mountains of gold and silver, like wow, right? I mean, forget gold and silver. When they put a PC World or Currys or any of the shops 70% off of Black Friday, people are lining up outside for 2 days. And it's not a gold, it's not a mountain of gold. When the new iPhone 6S came out, I think the people in UK stood there for two days or something like that, queued up so that they can get the first iPhone 6S. That the hordes and hordes and mountains of gold and silver becomes beautiful in the eyes of people. In today's time, you can look at, you know, some people, they'd love to see their bank statement, and some people don't like it. No, it's not funny. Okay. Some people love to see their bank statement because the bank statement says you have $10 million in your account. And some people, they say you have 10 pounds. For those people who have $10 million in their, 10 million pounds in their account, when they look at it, they want to keep looking at it. I love this figure. I don't want this figure to go any lower, not even one penny, because it's just such a beautiful figure of 10 million pounds. Because if even one sterling goes down, then it's not 10 million, it's another figure. It becomes beautiful. Imagine if tomorrow in your account, all of a sudden 10 million pounds show up. How many times are you going to look at that statement? Oh my God, oh my God, oh my God. قناطير المقنطرة من الذهب والفضة والخيل المصبمة and fast horses. You know, that's the proof outside. Fast horses are fast cars today. The faster the car, Bugatti, for example. You guys are in, you live in this world, right? Bugatti, you all know Bugatti, right? It's one of the fastest cars, about, you know, 8 radiators to keep it cool. Right? About 1 million, 2 million, I don't know how much your sterling pounds would cost. It's a very, very fast, 0 to 60, this many. You know. So the fastest the Tesla has made their new, you know, cars, and their cars are pretty fast as well, and they made it even the auto driving cars. So the faster the car, oh my God. And the groceries and the food and the cattle and the meat. ذَلِكَ مَتَاعُ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. These are nothing but just the pleasures of this world. Meaning what? They're only beautiful in the eyes of those people who just want to stay in this world. And that's what you and I want to do. This is the truth. You and I just want to stay in this world. Nobody wants to die. It's all just saying, I want to go to heaven. You know, everybody wants to go to heaven, but nobody wants to die. Guess what? In order to go to heaven, first you have to die. And because we just want to live here forever, these are the pleasures of this world, and they become beautiful. But if you will look at it, why, we're not going to stay here forever. This is just like a hotel room. We are here for 3 or 4 days and we're going to leave. We are going to go back to the place where we're going to live forever. This is not our abode. Regardless of how things are, how beautiful they seem, we will not get attached to it. They will not become beautiful to us. When you go to a hotel room, you might have the best of TVs, the best of beds, the best of the lamps, the best of everything. You don't get attached to it. Why? Because you know you're only here for one night or two nights and you're leaving. Your life and my life compared to eternity is just not even blink of an eye. But we want to stay here forever. And these things are just the pleasure or means of this world. They're not your end. Your end is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the people in Karbala understood that tawheed. They understood that Tawheed, that our success, measuring scale of our success, is a submission to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in that process, whether we are killed, whether we are imprisoned, this is not the final of our stay. We have to go back to him. Inna lillah wa inna ilayhi raji'un. And the people in Kufa were people like me who wanted to stay in this world forever. I won't say you. Therefore, the mothers, they went and they grabbed their sons. The wives went and grabbed their husbands. The sisters went and grabbed their brothers and left Hazrat Muslim ibn Aqil all alone. But the 7,200 followers of Imam Hussein Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, they stood with him. When the lights were turned down and they were told to leave, who left? Heaven has been promised to them. We can't leave. You are our heaven. What would be this life without you? What would be this life? When Bibi Zainab was asking Imam Hussain, have you tested your friends? Imam Hussain comes out, his friends are standing with swords on their neck. Shamala, you want us to remove our necks right now? What have we done? The Bibi is asking this. That the princess is asking this. We can take our necks right now. Ain al Hassan, Ain al Hussein. Where is our Imam? Where is our Imams? And we're okay. Thursday comes, the next day is Friday, nobody's even thinking about him. Where is our success? This person is standing there, an old man is crying. Imam Hussain comes to him, says, why are you crying? His son was on the battlefield. Said, Imam Hussain said, don't worry. Soon you will be having a cup of drink from Hawza Kawthar, from the hands of the Holy Prophet. Don't worry. Don't cry. The man replied, I'm not crying because of that. Imam, I'm crying because I will go. And between you and me, there will be a distance. I'm crying because of that I cannot bear the distance between you and me. We haven't seen our Imam for the last 1200 years. This difference has been 1200 years. What is our condition? We're still okay. This person couldn't bear the fact that for a few minutes he would not see Imam Hussain. When Imam Hussain said, don't worry, I am coming after you, he had a smile on his face. That is someone who's understood Tawheed. He's understood that this is a transient world. I'm not going to stay here forever. My success is Hussain. My success is to submit to him because he is the Imam of the time and he is the representative of Allah. Whatever he says, I have to do. This is the success of Hazrat Abbas. This is his loyalty. In front of the Imam of the time, he put his head down. Okay, you ask me just to go get water, I'll just go get water. He understood Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said, my God who has given me this as the Imam of the time, his obedience is the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that I have been obeying all of my life. Then his forehead had the black spot of the sujood, like the knee of a camel. That's a pass. Allah, through your wisdom, through your knowledge, through your power, give us the opportunity to understand you, to submit to your will. to make the coming of that Imam as soon as possible. For us to have the true shape of your understanding of Tawheed, and that we are truthful in our statement of La ilaha illallah. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim wa al-Asr. Inna al-insana lafi khusr illa al-ladhina amanu wa amanu s-salihat wa tawassu bil-haq wa tawassu s-salihat.